brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA.
Classic Car or Muscle Car, we want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
Right now on Autorestomod, Jeff turns into a shut-in, Caleb tries to help, and we discover some cool information on cooling.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-Day Only Mega Sale.
You don't need a sale. You need NPD.
NPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
All right, folks, this week we're going to be talking about cooling your classic car, specifically working on our 1967 Camaro with its clapped out radiator, funky corrugated hoses, and really ugly big fan shroud. We're going to be getting rid of all that this week. Mother of pearl! Wow! Fingers out. Somebody come over here and open the hood. There's a hit. Folks. We'll be right back. Hurt. Okay, so what we've got here on the table is the radiator that we got from the guys at National Parts Depot, along with a fan kit from them as well. So what we're going to talk about is this radiator. I like this. It's a beautiful piece. When we unboxed it, I was kind of amazed at how nice this looked. Pictures in the catalog really don't do it any justice. What we have, though, is a nice high fin count, high tube count radiator. There's a lot of cooling squeezed into this small area, and you want to get as much cooling as you possibly can out of your radiator. This Champion that we got is going to give us everything we need. It's got a nice polish to it, and it has the cooling area for the automatic transmission. You'll want to take these plastic plugs out and go in and put some nice brass plugs in here to make this look a little bit more neat, along with the rest of the nice look on this radiator. I'm going to talk about something real quick here. One of our camera guys actually asked why this was dirty, assuming that maybe the radiator, when it came in the packaging, was actually a used radiator. What happens is, with a lot of these radiators, like the one we have here on the table, is they will actually do a wet tank test. They'll plug the radiator up and they'll actually run air into the radiator to check for leaks. That's the way you'll check for leaks a lot of times whenever you're doing this at a radiator shop as well, just if you're getting one recored. When they do new radiators, rather than putting coolant or water inside the radiator, they'll actually plug it up so it's nice and dry inside for storage, and they'll actually dunk this into a solution and see if they get any air bubbles coming off the radiator. If they don't get any air bubbles coming off the radiator and the radiator doesn't lose pressure in the tank, because they'll put a pressure gauge on it, they'll know that they've got a good, clean, solid running radiator, and they can ship it out the door. So, if you see this on your packaging when you open your radiator up, it's not a problem. It's just from the water that's been sitting on the fins a lot of times, and it'll get on this and make it look kind of suspect, but it's not. So now we're going to move on to the fan shroud that we're going to be using. Now, this radiator can be bought without a fan shroud, but you can also get it with a fan and shroud assembly for the Camaro. This is a really nice little setup. I like the way this looks. It'll play really nicely with our radiator. And it's got a 1900 CFM fan. If we can't get enough airflow across that condenser and radiator for our AC setup with this fan assembly, we've got some problems. So this comes as a kit with the mounting hardware. Now the fan does come, if you buy it separately, does come with this assembly kit here to put it on a car, but that's right out, because we're going to be using the assembly kit that we got from the guys at National Parts Depot. Next on the table has absolutely nothing to do with cooling, but the fact that I like the way they look better. This car has the nice little corrugated hoses on it. Hate them. Don't like them. I like the way the factory hoses look a lot better. It cleans up the look of that engine bay, makes it look really nice. And from National Parts Depot, you can get literally all the hoses that were available on a 1967 through whatever year model Camaro that you're working on. They carry this stuff for that all the way up to the third gens. Finally, we've got a mounting kit for the radiator hoses. This is a factory original mounting stuff. We're going to be using those on here because we want to keep a nice factory look on some of this stuff. I always like using factory style hardware when I can because it just has a much neater, more industrial look, which plays really well inside that engine bay. So now we're going to go talk about some of the things you're going to want to look for whenever you're trying to keep your car cool, no matter what you're running. Onward and forward. Apparently, we're going to need to put some hood springs on this car before everything's all over with, because this is what I need to use to hold the hood open. Right, so cooling is much more than just your radiator. There's a lot of other things that will come into play whenever you're working on one of these classic cars and trying to keep everything cool. There's things that can be misleading, and then there's other things that you need to make sure you're working with. For instance, pulleys are a big issue. So you've got a set of pulleys, like the ones that Caleb's just brought to me here. You may go now. And what we've got here are the pulleys that we got from the guys at Classic Auto Wear. Now these pulleys are basically a 1-to-1 ratio, and that's what you want whenever you're trying to keep your car as cool as you possibly can. You want your water pump pulley to be about the same diameter as your harmonic balancer pulley. With that being the case, you're going to get a good 1-to-1 cooling ratio on this. Anytime you're running anything underdriven, particularly let's say your harmonic balancer pulley, or you're running an underdriven water pump pulley, you're going to end up having issues with it wanting to not cool as well because you're not turning the water pump at the same rate as your engine is running. That's why it's a good idea to keep these pulleys at a 1-to-1 ratio. I'm going to set these aside real quick and we're going to talk a little bit about sending units and gauges. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about the pulleys. Now we're going to talk about gauges. This car has in it a set of Dakota Digital gauges. Now the Dakota Digital stuff is really nice. It's a fairly accurate gauge set. But what I would recommend you doing in all cases is getting yourself a really good, in the case of these gauges, a digital thermometer and testing your sender. Most of the senders that are sent out now for these type of gauges are fairly accurate. But if you're talking about a classic car with original style gauges in it, these gauges can be an issue whenever you're trying to make sure your temperatures are correct. Stuff like these things from Dakota Digital are very accurate, and the sending units that they send with them are really nice. But if you're working with a set of original instruments in the car, a lot of times those instruments are not, let's say, as accurate as they could be. And you want to know what your readings are. So what we did is we did a video a while back on how to test your gauges and make sure you know what your readings are telling you. But what you'll want to do is you want to make sure that your gauges are accurate, because you may indeed not have a heating problem. You may in fact have a gauge issue. So check that out before you go any further with this. Make sure your gauges are accurate, because if your gauges aren't accurate, guess what? You're not going to know what your temperatures are. So downflow versus crossflow radiators. There's a lot of people that talk about this in the industry, and people will tell you need to put a crossflow radiator in it. And I'm going to tell you right now, according to everything I've read so far, it really doesn't make one whit of difference as long as your core size is as big as you can possibly get and the opening available in your car. That's really what's going to dictate your cooling, is the opening in the front of the radiator core support. If you have a small opening, you're going to have to run a small radiator or do something to open that core support up to allow you to put a bigger radiator in it. These two, believe it or not, this is a Ford radiator and this is the GM radiator that we're putting in from National Parts Depot. These two radiators, as far as size, are within about a half an inch of each other on core size. Fin count, this one has a higher fin count because it's a newer aluminum radiator. This is an older brass radiator that still has the original fin setups in it. And you can see that there's a big difference between the spacing on the fins on these two. This one has a little tighter fin count and a little smaller fin count. And the tube count is, believe it or not, within two tubes of each other. This one's a 38 and this one is a 40 tube count. Not a whole lot of difference. You're still going to get good cooling out of it. One disadvantage I can say that you can have with a downflow radiator like this is that you can have your inlet and outlet on the same side. That can create some problems with it wanting to suck the hot coolant right straight down rather than having it cross over to the tube on the other side of the radiator like this one. Now this is a 1968 original Ford Motor Company big block radiator. So this radiator is what it would have been back in 1968, and it has the cross flow on it, like Ford set it up, for big block applications. On a 68, you can, with a little bit of modification, put one of these style radiators in a classic Mustang, and it will do everything you need it to do. But what we're really talking about here is efficiencies, and quite frankly, everything I've read so far says that top and bottom tank radiators like this one really aren't any less efficient than the ones like this that are cross flows. This one's just nice and pretty, and aluminum, and going in the Camaro we're working on. Right, so another problem that you can run into with your radiator may not be the radiator itself. Your overheating issues could actually come from the engine. I see a lot of times with especially the Ford FEs and 351 Cleveland series of engines that because of the thin wall castings and some of the overboring that are done to these engines, they can run into a problem with heating and hot spotting inside of the cylinder walls, causing it to put too much heat into the radiator system and just overpowering it. You want to make sure that your engine bores are in a good shape, that you don't have them too thin. You also want to make sure that you don't have a head gasket problem. Now, if you have, say, a small block 350 or any other type of engine like this, you can go down to the auto parts store and get yourself a head gasket test kit that will allow you to know whether or not you do have a head gasket issue. It may be something slight enough that you're not able to see it out the tailpipe, but heavy enough that it's pulling fluid out of the radiator and just shortchanging you on your fluids, so that at some point you start to overheat. Another thing that's probably a good idea to do when you're doing a radiator is to put a catch can on it. Especially on these older cars, the catch can will allow you to pull the fluid back into the system. National Parts Depot offers these. You can also get these from other places like Summit and areas like that. So those are a couple little things on the engine side and the radiator side that you can look at to keep your engine cool. Now I'm going to go back over the table and talk to you about the differences between aluminum, brass, copper radiators. Okay, back at the table. Now we have the two radiators here. We have a brass radiator that is an original Ford product, and we have the aftermarket Champion radiator from National Parts Depot. And we wanted to go into some of the thermal dynamics of which is better. And between these two radiators, thermally speaking, the aluminum radiator is a better choice. Brass radiators like this one are not quite as efficient as an aluminum. Now, copper would be your most efficient, but copper is pretty dang expensive now to make a radiator out of, so you want to keep that in your mind when you're thinking about this. Brass, decent. Aluminum, better. Copper, best. So, from a thermal standpoint, this is your best choice for a radiator because it's going to be able to dissipate the heat better than the brass one we have right here. Okay? Okay, I'm going to sweep all this stuff off the table and talk to you a little bit about fans, your biggest fans. Okay, so fans, your biggest fans. This one on the far left is a flex fan, the one in the middle is a clutch fan, and the one on the end obviously is our fan that we're going to be using in our 67 Camaro. Now the one in the middle is a reproduction, and a very nice reproduction that NPD carries, of an original Ford big block clutch fan system. You can even see that it's got the logos on it here that it would have originally had back in 1968 when they were new. Totally a reproduction, still a really cool piece, and if I were going to do AC on a car, I would probably investigate using this actual fan because of the blade count, and it's going to pull a good bit of air through that radiator to make the cooling efficiencies a little bit better. I personally would stay away from the flex fans. I'm not real crazy about them. There have been some cases of these actually coming apart and exploding, causing real issues with your car. So I'm not crazy about using flex fans, would rather use a clutch. One of the best things you can do if you get the right CFM rating is to actually go with an electric fan. It's going to pull the same kind of amount of air that you're going to get with a clutch fan. And if you really want to increase your efficiencies, you can actually, if you have room in the front of the radiator, go in and put a push fan on the front and a pull fan on the back, and that will give you the maximum amount of cooling across that radiator that you can get. So, you have the three choices. My two choices out of these would be to go with a clutch fan, if you can, and if you don't want to get away from a stock look, and if you really don't give a crap, and you want it to just pull a lot of air, go with a couple of electrics, or a single electric with a shroud like the one we have from National Parts Depot. All right, now one more thing on all this. While I'm talking about the sensors, we have a thermostat inside this engine, and especially on engines like this one, that are EFI equipped, you're going to make sure you got a thermostat in there that's the correct thermostat for your application. That thermostat is going to regulate the coolant coming in, causing the computer to know what it needs to do with the fuel delivery and all that. On earlier cars, it's not as critical, but I still recommend you run a thermostat on earlier cars just so you get heating quicker into the engine. In other words, you want to get that engine up to operating temperature as quickly as you can. If you don't, you can end up having some problems with it wanting to do more wear to the engine. Can you run a car without a thermostat? Absolutely. Will it help performance? Not really at all. And the problem you run into with it is this. If you're having an overheating problem enough that you need to pull the thermostat out to fix it, you have a problem somewhere else in the engine that is probably not related to the thermostat. So, on a street car, I always recommend running a thermostat. It's just a good practice to keep the engine operating at normal temperatures. Okay? Okay. So, what do you put into your radiator? Well, believe it or not, some people will tell you that you should just go ahead and put tap water. That's right, folks, plain old tap water. If you can get softened water, that's probably the best thing you can put in there, along with antifreeze. The only reason you're putting this in here is for winter months when it's cold. Your water is your best thing for keeping the engine cool. Now, some of the engines, like some of the Ford V6s, are real prone to needing the antifreeze in there to help keep this from boiling up. So antifreeze is not a bad idea, but oddly enough, most people I've talked to recommend you using tap water and not using distilled. If you can't get softened water, use tap water. If you use distilled, you're gonna need to do like a 50-50 mix between antifreeze and your distilled water, because the distilled water does actually start pulling ions out of your aluminum or magnesium or whatever inside your engine and indeed inside your aluminum radiator and causing it to, for lack of a better term, molt. And you don't want that because it'll start eating away at the aluminum over time. I don't know that it's enough that you're going to see a whole lot of difference, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 years down the road, but still, if you want to be really good about this, oddly enough, throw some tap water in there with some antifreeze, you're gonna be good to go. I've always put distilled water in it, and now I've learned from doing some research on all this that distilled water is not the best thing for your radiator. So, don't use this, just get some old tap water. You'll be fine, seriously. So, are we going to show you how to remove and install a radiator in a 1967 Camaro? No, we're not gonna do that at all. This is pretty straightforward. It doesn't really require that much work. What we will tell you is this, is that's all got to come out anyway for what we're doing with the AC system. So what we want to do with our Camaro over here is we want to go in and show you things that are really important, like how to get the heater box out of one of those cars, which is, oddly enough, a very involved process and something we'll be focusing on next week on Autorestomod. Have a great week, folks. I'm going to go put a radiator in.